SVFD Brian Foster-Dow in the house for an episode of After Action with Rick Fryer. You're a fire science guy, a residential expert on everything except everything else. When did you get hired?
I was hired in 1991, September 16th. Yeah, I was 91-2, so there was two groups of five hired that year. And that was in the second group with Ken and Andy and Terry Soderberg and Ethan Cast.
Okay, so holy crap, you've been doing this 31 years if I did the math right.
30 and 6 months. And then I had some, I was with another department for a couple years before I got hired here. I was a resident firefighter in Kitsap County, District 10.
You were my battalion chief for a while.
Yep.
We won't talk about that period of time. There's no reason to bring that up.
Yeah, hired in 91. A year after, so it'd be 92, they were putting out for paramedic tests, and you had to have 2 years on to be to test for a paramedic, but there wasn't enough interest, like none. So they opened it up to 1 year guys. So several of us who only had 1 year on said, yeah, please, and went to paramedic school after a year on. So that was Dave Fay was in that class, Ken Kapal, Reese Evans, Dennis Doyle. I love being on the spot because, especially early 90s, we went on everything. All fires, car accidents, BLS calls too. So Squad 5 had, I think it was East of Pines, Squad 1 was West of Pines. And you went on everything because we only went on about 3,000 to 4,000 calls a year. So not a lot, but it was a nice way to get lots of action,
right.
Being on the squad as opposed to being on one of the engines.
Right, back then, you know.
And it had the extrication equipment and the line gun and the electrical stuff, and yeah, it was a lot of fun.
So we changed from lieutenants and captains to captains. When did that happen? Right. Were you a lieutenant, then a captain?
I was a lieutenant first, yeah. Okay. And at Station 7 and Station 5, primarily. Actually, Station 2 first, but I take that back. Susan Pine was my first engineer.
Okay.
At Station 2.
Old Station 2?
Yep, old Station 2.
Over there on Trent?
Yep.
Right. Because I worked there a couple times.
Yeah. And I worked there quite a bit as just a paramedic with Bill Anderson and Danny Young as my captain and lieutenant. My first fire as an out-of-class battalion chief, I think I'd been in the car once, and this was Thanksgiving, either the day before or Thanksgiving Day. And at that time, there was only one BC. I'd only done that job once. And we get a commercial fire, the Nora fire. So fully involved, large commercial building with exploding canisters of chemicals. And I'm the BC. it went well. It went okay. Despite my best efforts, but that was an eye opener.
As a battalion chief, when you show up on a code, what's your job?
So my primary job, in my view, was to liaise with the family. Back in the day, before BCs were really on those calls, the family was kind of ignored, except for a few inputs on hey, what happened and the history, and then they were kind of ignored. I think it's much better this way because I'm there talking to them the whole time. Explaining what's going on, trying to get more information.
Right, patient history.
Right. And hopefully they feel like there's a little more control with them having that information instead of wondering what the heck's going on. But it was also one of the toughest jobs, I think, for me, is dealing with families in distress and grieving. And that had a big impact on me. I think one of my favorite and most fun legacies, hopefully that I'm leaving, is the pipe band. So I was one of the first honor guard people. So we started honor guard with Valley. And I thought, why don't we start a pipe band? And then they said, yeah, go do that thing. And started the pipe band in 2002. And that's morphed into the county band now. There's a couple of us who still have Valley uniforms and we'll wear those for our people when they pass and or Valley celebrations. But that's been one of the most fun things, and the last one I got to do was the deputy over in Pierce County, Colada, Deputy Colada. I got to play for him.
I am so glad you brought that up because on the drive over here this morning, I'm like, dude, you got to talk about the band. But you fell through a floor.
I did. Yeah.
When was that? That was early. That was before I got hired.
Yeah. I was a medic. I think it was 94, maybe? Maybe 95. I was on an engine, I don't remember which one, it might have been engine one with Mark Kiefer. Anyways, we come up to this house, and to the right of the front door, along the sill plate, there were some little lazy flames there. It burned through the sill plate. And we had just gone to an investigation class talking about trailers. And the front door, I don't know if it was open or reopened it, but you could see burnt carpet trails on the carpet. And it was like, hey, those are trailers. We just learned about that. And the floor was completely straight. There was no sagging or anything. I said, oh, something worked that. And this is before we did 360s, or we're real good about our communications initially and the tasks we did initially. So we're just going to walk through the front door instead of going around, see if there's a better way to get where we're going to go. But there's no smoke that I remember in the first floor. It was a little rancher. And had a tile threshold. And my first step through into the house, I went right through to the floor in the basement. Luckily, I landed on my side, and there was nothing underneath there for me to land on, so I wasn't hurt at all. I just remember looking up through the hole at Mark Kiefer, looking down at me, and he reached down like he was going to pull me out, and you know, at the time, I was 250 plus gear, so you know, over 300 pounds of weight to pull me out of the hole, and I knew he was going to do that, and I wasn't burning. There was no fire down there. So I looked and saw the stairs, and all Mark said, he said, he saw my hands come up and then they disappeared because it was all dark down there. And, he didn't know what the heck was going on. And, I just walk up the stairs and come out, in the kitchen, and I can see them at the front door. There are three guys looking down the hole. And then I said, hey, I'm okay. Yeah. Lucky, very lucky.
I like the way you talked about how we wouldn't do that today.
Right.
We wouldn't do a 360.
Yep.
We would. I mean, just the things that have changed.
And sound the floor.
And sound the floor. Right? It's funny how that stuff, yeah. You know, and again, we're constantly playing catch up with the speed and aggression that we want to use.
Right.
That could have had something to do with your desire to, like, improve as a VC and become a better, you know, like, steward of the scene.
I didn't want to lose anybody because of my... the way I communicated or operated or my knowledge base or my awareness of what was going on. That was my greatest fear, is to have someone hurt or killed. And I think I would feel personally responsible, even if it wasn't my fault. I was in charge of that scene, and I wanted to create an environment where the chances of that was as small as possible. It's an inherently dangerous job, but you know, if we approach it the right way and communicate clearly and calmly, hopefully it, prevents that or minimizes that risk.
So you mentioned how even if it wasn't something specifically that you did or didn't do, you would still feel responsible
because
it was your scene.
Right.
They have a definition for that. It's called leadership.
Yeah.
You're a good man, Charlie Brown.
Thank you, sir.
But you can't stay here.
Nope.
You gotta leave and take, yeah. Take your bearded face.
And, yeah, absolutely. I'm gonna do that.
Go enjoy.
Gotta go work on my boat.
It ain't what you show up for.
No. Semper Gumby.
Always flexible. Man, I love it. You're a Marines kid. Good for you. That's all right. Semper Gumby, baby. Well.